Hi there, I'm Clarence Waldron. Welcome back to another exciting episode of Black Muse. Fonda Bryant, the daughter of R&B legend Johnny Taylor, is our guest tonight. We're all familiar with his music. We know the songs. Who's Making Love? What About My Love? She Be the Keeper and Disco Lady. Fonda went through one legal battle after another to be declared an heir of Johnny Taylor. That battle is detailed in the current best-selling book, and I got it right here, I Believe in You, The Incredible Journey of R&B Legend Johnny Taylor. Yes, it's definitely a must-read. It's a must-read. It's very well-researched, very well-researched. And it was written by Gregory Hastie and T.J. Hooker Taylor. Meanwhile, Fonda is a survivor, a suicide survivor, who has turned her attention to teaching people about suicide prevention. Let me just stop talking. Let's meet Miss Fonda Bryant, y'all. Hey, Fonda, how are you?
I'm doing well. How are you doing? Thank you so much for having me. It's really good to see you.
I know, we haven't seen each other in years.
We haven't seen each other face to face in years. We'll talk with text and talk on the phone, but we haven't seen each other. So it's really good to see you.
Yeah, very good to have you here. But let's start at the very beginning. When did you learn that Johnny Taylor was your father?
Well, you know, my mom never kept that from me. And I guess she waited until I was old enough to understand a little about mother and father. So she told me when I was about 5 years old, and she actually had a picture back in the day when they had the posters. She had it cut out, a picture of him. And if I'm not mistaken, it was something written on the back of it. But she had that picture and she told me, she said, this is who your father is. So, of course, I'm five. And I still don't understand, but I did understand enough that I had no father, you know, around like other kids did. So she told me when I was about 5 years old, and I always knew that.
Right. So when did you decide, let me prove that, I am indeed the daughter of Johnny Taylor? When did you decide to pursue that whole situation?
Well, you know, as I got older, the more I wanted to know about him. And then it was actually the Jet magazine that had my father's picture on the cover with my sister at the time that I thought was my sister, Sabrina. And that was the picture of my father in a tux, Sabrina in a white dress, or I guess her sweet 16. And I was in a junior high school working to help support my family. I wasn't just working to have money for myself. I was in high school, you know, in middle school, and now they call it middle school, but in junior high school, working at my junior high school. And when that came out, I looked at it and I just started crying because I'm like, I opened it and there was pictures of my brothers, sisters, grandparents, relatives, and they didn't know a thing about me. And I didn't know a thing about them. And when that happened, that's what I think kind of, when I saw that article, it hurt me deeply. And that's when I started saying, hey, you know what? I have got to reach out to him. Because my mom, I don't think she was reaching out to him anymore at the time. She just went on with her life. But for me, and people just don't really realize, you always long for your parents. Good, bad, indifference. You want to know him whether you can't stand him or not. And I wanted to know him. And then on top of that, he has all this money and fame, and he wasn't worried about me. He didn't know if I had clothes, if I had a place to live, if the woman he had a child with was taking care of me. He didn't know about that, didn't care. So when I saw that article, I got it in my little 14-year-old head that I was going to make my presence known to him.
So as the years went by, did you ever meet him, sit down and meet him?
No, as the years went by, one of the I when he came out with Disco Lady, I wrote to Columbia Records. I don't even know how I got that idea. I think I was about 16 or so, and I wrote to Columbia Records. Might have been older than that. And I didn't find out 2 years later after he died that all the letters that I wrote, well, actually, let me wind it back a little bit. When I turned 28 years old, that's when I had my first conversation with my father. 28 years old. I was living in Savannah. I was working as a pharmacist tech at Refco. And I got in touch with him and we talked on the phone. And automatically he started making excuses. Well, I know you're my daughter, but your mom remarried, so I didn't want to interfere. What does that have to do with me? And so that was our first interaction. And he told me that he had read all the letters that I had sent him. And when he died, Geraldine called my mother and said that she had found all those letters in the bottom of the closet, in his closet. And I wish she would have sent them back to me. But of course, because of the ugly court battle and how she is, she threw them in the trash. But he acknowledged me on the phone, and that started communication between us. But one thing about me, I don't take crap off people. I don't care who you are. And he could, you know, because he did the drugs and the alcohol, he would be high at times and you couldn't have a real conversation with him. And then I never will forget one conversation. He tried to tell me what I needed to do and all that stuff. And I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. You haven't been a parent at all. So you need to be quiet. So it was time that I would hang up on him because I wasn't going to sit there and listen to somebody who was making excuses and not taking accountability for being a father.
Wow. So now, thanks to you and his other children receive royalties today from Sony. How many kids did he have total?
Well, let's just put it this way. I'm
Mm.
sure I got brothers and sisters out there that I don't even know, but the official count from the court battle, there's nine of us, but there's only five living. Four have passed away. Johnny Taylor Jr., Anthony, Floyd, and Chiffon, the one that I was the closest to, Chiffon. So, and then the thing is with Johnny, with Floyd and Chiffon, they died a couple of days apart, both from heart attacks. Both from
Really?
heart attacks. So I didn't have a rapport with any of them. Now, Chiffon and I got along really good, but it's only five of us left now. And it is myself, TJ Hooker, Latasha, Jonathan, and Sabrina. So it's only five of us left. And I now have a rapport with TJ, but the rest of them I do not, especially the two youngest ones, Jonathan and Latasha, because they did some really shady stuff along with their mother. Because the death certificate for my father,
Yes.
when he died, it was signed that Geraldine had the funeral director and knows market where she was still married to him. And that wasn't true. My father died May 31st, 2000. He divorced Geraldine May 10th, 2000. They were divorced. So they were able to use a forged phony death certificate to be able to go to one of the streaming services we get royalty from that we didn't know about until I got the money from Sony. And they set up and held themselves out to being the only two children of Johnny Taylor. And they stole over 200 and something thousand dollars from the nine heirs, the other seven heirs. And I had to go after them. I wasn't gonna let them get away with that. And once the record company realized that their mistake, they have frozen their account, Latasha and Jonathan, and they will not get a penny until they pay us all back. So that's the kind of stuff that I'm constantly dealing with, along with just people being ignorant, saying ugly things online, like you're not his child, he didn't love you. It doesn't matter because DNA doesn't lie. DNA does not lie. It can free people from prison, it can put people in prison. So regardless of how he treated me or didn't treat me, I do better off now in his death than I do when he was living, because any royalty money that we get, Clarence, I look at that as back child support. I sure
Absolutely.
do. That's back child support. So you can say whatever you want to say, because in the state of Texas, in Dallas County, in the probate court, that DNA discovery is there. And it says
Bingo.
99.999% I'm his daughter. But it also proved that Sabrina, the one that was on the cover of Essence, I mean, Jet Magazine and all of that stuff, she's not my sister by blood. She's not. She can claim she is, and she was born of the marriage. So she does get royalties. But other than that, it was so funny to me that the person who was up under him all the time, that proclaimed that she was his daughter and treated me really bad when we met each other face to face, does not, we don't have the same blood running through us at all.
Right. Who knew that? Who would have thought that?
Yeah, but that's what did, that's the wonderful thing about DNA.
Yeah.
You got 50% of your dad, 50% of your mom, and it does not lie.
Yeah. So looking back now, have you learned to forgive him or to try to forgive him, do you think?
Yes. You know something? This work that I do, it's changed me a lot. Because I, like I told you, I don't take crap off people. I'm very straightforward, but you have to sometimes peel those things back. And the great thing about when you take care of your mental health and you become mentally healthy, you can look at things a lot clearer and you can forgive people. And when I look at the fact that our culture, Clarence, has come from generational trauma, it's easier for me to be able to look at my father and see generational trauma. He grew up during a time when there was great, you know, racism, and we could get killed just looking at somebody white. He also, from just looking at some of the film that I've seen with different things, you know, his father left him. He ended up being raised by his grandmother. Then he moved to Kansas City, Missouri, and lived with his mother. That's trauma. That's a lot of trauma going on. So when I realized drugs and alcohol, because I used to think, oh, I'm better than people. Even when I went in the psychiatric hospital in 1995, I thought I was better than people who did drugs and alcohol. Well, through my education with mental health, I realized self-medicating doesn't have to be drugs and alcohol. It can be pornography, sex, excessive eating, excessive shopping, excessive working out. And so I've been able to take all of that into account with my father. Now, you're still accountable. Part of mental wellness is being accountable for your behavior. He was never made to be accountable for us. But I have forgiven him because I know my father went through trauma. And people just don't pick up one day and say, you know what? I'm gonna do drugs and alcohol and ruin my life. Self-medicating and mental health go hand in hand. Because you think about it, in our culture, we have come from generational trauma. Mental health help was not invented for Black people. Poor white people, people of color, it was only invented for the rich or whoever could afford it. Sometimes Black people, famous people would go to a sanitarium or whatever. So, but how did we cope as Black people? We started self-medicating. When you look at some of our biggest entertainers, from Lil Walter to Etta James to Billie Holiday to Whitney Houston to Michael Jackson to Prince, you look at how did they cope with their lives. They self-medicated, and my father was no different. Paul Williams with the Temptations. You know, you look at James Brown, all of them self-medicated because that's how they coped. And now, through education and a little bit of the stigma going away in our culture, Black people are starting to see, hey, it's okay to go talk to somebody. It's okay to get help. But back then, that was a no-no. It could ruin their career because they didn't want people to think they were crazy. Look at Donny Hathaway, you know. So again, I've been able to forgive my father because of the work that I do. Now, he still should have been accountable for that. That didn't let him off the hook. He knew right from wrong. But I've been able to forgive him because of the work that I do. And some of this work that I do, because I help people with substance abuse, is because of my father. And I really wish that he would have lived where I could have helped him to get off the drugs and the alcohol and see he could live a good life without it.
Right. Wow. So tell us more about your suicide prevention program. How does it work? Is it online? Is it an address for our viewers to,
Yeah.
whatever? Talk about that.
Well, I became a certified QPR, question, persuade, refer,
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
suicide prevention instructor in March of 2018. And since when COVID hit, as bad as it was really a blessing for me because to kill time and to keep my mental health intact, I started training people online. And I sat down the other day and figured it out. I've done over 400 trainings since March of 2018. I've done over 400 trainings, and most of them been online, but in person. And so the training is very simple. It does four things. Number one, QPR is like CPR. I always ask people, how many of y'all are CPR trained? CPR is to help somebody in a physical crisis. You administer CPR, you can help them live, whether having a heart attack or stroke. Now, if that person dies on the way to the hospital or down the road, is that your fault? No, because you did everything you could to save their life. QPR is the same thing. It's to help somebody in a mental health crisis or suicidal. And if we save that person's life, and then they die by suicide down the road, it's not your fault because we have to want to live. I have to put in the work every single day as a 29-year survivor of suicide. I was diagnosed in 1995 after almost taking my own life with clinical depression. Depression is the number one debilitating disease in the world. It is also the number one disease that can cause us to die by suicide. It is a disease that is never going to go away. So I have to put in the work every single day. So QPR training is to teach anyone from a youth to adult, you can save a life. You don't have to be a professional. So it teaches you, number one, how to recognize the signs of someone in crisis or suicidal. Number two, it helps you to gauge your mental health. Am I doing okay today? Maybe I need to go talk to somebody. Number three, if you pick up on the signs, the earlier you pick up on the warning signs of suicide, or someone in crisis, you can prevent them from going into crisis or becoming suicidal. And the last thing it does that I really love, it gives you the confidence to approach someone who might be in crisis or suicidal. Because a lot of times when I train people, they'll say, well, the reason why I didn't intervene, I didn't know what to do or what to say, and I felt like I was gonna make it worse. So I teach you what to say, what to do, what not to say, what not to do. And once you get finished with the training, you get a certificate that lasts for 2 years. You're a certified gatekeeper. You get a QPR booklet in PDF form. If I do the training in person, you get the booklet in your hand, and you just get all of this great information in an email that I send you that can help you. Because I've had people from students to adults who have reached back out to me and told me, hey, I use your training to save someone's life. It really does give you spider sense because you will look at people differently. You will listen more intently. So my trainings, I do one free training a month online. It is 2 hours. If anybody wants to reach out to me, they can. I put my email out there. I put my social media contact out there, and they can reach out to me. There's no registration. I tell everybody, you need to be on time and you need to take the entire 2 hours of training. And my motto is become someone's hero, like my Aunt Spanky became mine 29 years ago. And also, what is 2 hours out of your day if you're learning how to save someone's life? And I train an array of people from high school students to college students, to adults, to police officers. I'm now training the rookie officers of Charlotte-Mecklenburg Police Department because the number one cause of death for them is not in the line of duty, it's suicide. And in our culture, Clarence, we've always been raised, Black people don't die by suicide. Well, here's a stat for you. Right now, suicide from 2018 to 2021 for Black people, it has rose 11.2%. 36.6 increase. Suicide, yes, suicide is now the second leading cause of death for Black males, 10 to 24. Black males have the highest rate of suicide out of any ethnic group, and 80% of suicides in the Black community are Black males. They're Black males. But guess what? Suicide is rising among Black females.
Good stuff. Now, what is your social media handle so people
Well,
can.
my social media is Fonda Bryant on Facebook, or you can reach out to me on X. I still call it Twitter. Twitter or Instagram, ProudMom72, or you can email me at Fonda, FONDANC, underscore the number 40 at yahoo.com. So that's how you can reach out to me. I do one training a month. Next month is Suicide Prevention Month. I'm gonna be very busy, but if we, the more people we train, the more lives that are saved. And if we save one person's life, it's worth it. It's really worth it. Because when I train people who also have lost people to suicide. And when we're going through those warning signs and things, sometimes they'll tell me in the email, those were the signs that my loved one was displaying, and I didn't know what they were. Because people always think we're flailing our arms saying, oh my God, I'm gonna kill myself.
Right.
But it can be something very subtle. You remember Twitch, the famous dancer and DJ on the Ellen Show? He did something that most people would have overlooked because his grandfather did. He called his grandfather and he told him, he said, I love you. His grandfather said, where did that come from? He was saying goodbye. He was saying goodbye. So it's when I do QPR training, I take it very seriously. I put it in my own mixture, and I don't brag a lot, but I think I'm one of the best QPR instructors out there because I have, good or bad, that lived experience. And I know what it's like to deal with that.
Yeah, let's go to that experience. Your Aunt Spanky, how did she save you? How did she keep you alive? Thank God she did.
Yes,
come on
thank
now,
you.
come on now.
Yeah, thank goodness she did, because, you know, because of my Aunt Spanky saving my life, other people are here. She's helped save other people's lives. So how it went about was I was in tremendous pain on Valentine's Day, 1995, a day of love and cards and flowers. I was in tremendous pain. And I tell people all the time, that's real pain. From the top of my head to the bottom of my feet, I was in excruciating pain. It felt like a bear was squeezing the life out of me. So I had a plan. So I wanted somebody to know that I was not gonna be here. I was gonna take my own life. So I called my hero. That's why I said anybody can become someone's hero. I called my Aunt Spanky. We're 3 years apart, always been close. And I simply said, you can have my shoes. A sign of giving away prized possessions. It doesn't have to be a monetary value. It doesn't have to be money or jewelry. It can be something that you know that person has a sentimental attachment to and they value it. And if they want you to have it, you don't say, well, thank you very much. I appreciate it. No, you need to ask them straight out. Are you thinking about suicide? Are you thinking about killing yourself? Let me help you get help. So I called my Aunt Spanky, and I simply remember saying, you could have my shoes. Now, she could have said Tweety, because my nickname is Tweety. She could have said, Tweety's having a bad day. I'm just going to leave her alone. If she had, I wouldn't be here, neither would other people. So I called, she called me back. She said, are you going to kill yourself? And I said, yes. And she went into action like Superman. And even though I didn't know what she was going to do that day, because I popped back to who I was, because I'm like, it's too late in the day to do it. I didn't want Wesley to be at home, my son that was 12 at the time. So I said, I'm just going to love on Wesley today and enjoy my life. And then tomorrow I'll be out of this pain and Wesley will be better off. Now, that was my line of thinking, because we don't want to die. We really just want that pain to go away. And we feel like the only way for it to go away is it for us to take our own lives, because we feel like we're going to be in that pain forever. So I had no idea that she had went downtown Charlotte and had sworn out papers to have me involuntarily committed. So I had got Wesley getting ready to order a pizza. There was a knock at the door. This big Charlotte Mecklenburg police officer came to the door. He's like, are you Fonda Bryant? I said, yes. He said, I came to take you to a mental health facility. And I said, no, you did not. And I went up the stairs to my bedroom. He came up behind me. Wesley came up behind me some kind of way. And we're in there going back and forth. He said, you're going? I said, no, I'm not. And then this is something I teach when I do QPR training. I tell everybody, I don't care if it's your husband, your wife, your partner, your friend, your girl, whoever it is. Don't put your hands on us when we're in crisis. Because in that moment, we're not thinking clearly. We can be in a manic state. We can be hallucinating, psychosis state. And if you put your hands on us, we can hurt you. You can hurt us. We can both get hurt. And that's exactly what happened. When that police officer put his hand on my shoulder, I don't smoke, drink, never done drugs. I scratched him. And when I scratched him, he grabbed me by the back of my neck. He shook me extremely hard and threw me in handcuffs. And if it wasn't for Wesley at the time, who was 12, who said, "Mom, please come down. You need help," I could have gotten seriously injured or killed. So I tell people, when we're in crisis, you stay calm. You don't call us names. You don't yell at us, and you don't curse us. Because what's going to happen if you do that? You're going to escalate it to situation to the point you can't handle us, and then you're going to have to call the police. And then we know how Black people feel about police and coming to help us. But in 1995, we did not have these police officers. Now we do. Every city, every state has CIT officers, crisis intervention team officers, that can help us with addiction, mental health, and suicide. And it's a totally different experience. They come, it's not about drawing guns on us or taking us to jail. It is about helping us get the help that they need. Now, do I believe police officers should be helping us? Mm-mm. We're a lazy society. We need to do better on the front end so they won't have to help us. But trust me, I'm glad that we have CIT officers. But as far as that went with me and my Aunt Spanky, I was so upset with her because I couldn't believe she did that to me, because I didn't think anything was wrong with me. But fast forward now, you know what makes her a hero? And this is what I always tell people. She went up against my mother, my grandmother, and me to save my life. She didn't care that we got mad at her, because all of us were mad at her. She saved my life. And see, this is what I always tell people, especially when I'm training Black people. Because we're so family oriented a lot of times. We don't want to ruffle feathers. And we're also a culture of secrets. We like to sweep stuff up under the rug and keep
Oh,
things in
yes.
house. And that does not
Oh.
help us. So I always tell people, you got two choices when we're in crisis or suicidal. You can help us. And yeah, we might get mad at you, might not ever speak to you again, but we're alive. And eventually we'll get over it. But if we don't, we're alive. Or you can do nothing and live with the why pain. And I call it the why pain. Why didn't I reach out? Why didn't I know the signs? Why didn't they reach out to me? Why? And that why pain can eat you up. So my Aunt Spanky will always be my hero, because she didn't hesitate like Superman. He doesn't hesitate when he sees trouble. He just leaps into action. That's what Aunt Spanky did. And that's why I always tell people, anybody can become someone's hero. And I love on her to death. And there was a documentary that my Aunt Spanky and I did a couple of years ago, a national documentary that ran on
Oh.
PBS called Facing Suicide. And I tell people all the time, I said, if y'all want to see two people who I was so mad at her on February 14th and see the difference now, we're sitting there doing that filming, and she's sitting there going through stuff that I can't remember, because that was so traumatic that I can't remember. But it just shows you that as bad as that day was and what she did to me, you can forgive that and move on and realize that if she hadn't have done that, you wouldn't be here. So she's always going to be my hero, always.
Wow, this has been a very lively conversation. Oh my God. Is there anything else that we missed that you want to touch on, or do we cover it all?
I think we covered it all, but I just want to let everybody know, if you're struggling, if you're going through something, please don't be ashamed to get help. Mental health is physical health. Mental health is health. And I'm telling you, if you take that first step, this is something I really want to emphasize, Clarence. I don't like being called a strong Black woman, because you know what that means? That means I have to put that mask on and pretend like everything's okay when it's not okay. So I will leave people with this. Real strength comes from saying, "I need help." Real strength comes from saying, "I'm going to get the help." And real strength comes from saying, "I'm getting the help, I'm putting in the work, and I'm going to be okay."
Bam, drop the mic. That's there
Yep,
it
there you go.
is. There
It
it
is.
is. Wow. Beautiful, beautiful,
Thank you so
beautiful.
much for having me. I'm so glad to see you.
Yeah. But listen, before we close, I want to acknowledge this is the 25th anniversary of Chicago West Community Music Center. And its founders, Howard Sandifer and Darlene Sandifer, they are the ones who are sponsoring this video podcast. So I want to give a very warm thank you to them. So
Thank you.
thank you. Alrighty now.